Welcome to Blooming Wildwood Homestead. Today we're going to look at some gift ideas for people in your life that are preserving their own food or want to get into preserving food. Some of these items are things that you definitely must have if you want to get into canning or other types of food preservation. And if you know somebody who is already doing those things, I have a couple of items on the list that I think would be maybe helpful if they don't already have something like that. The second part of the video is going to be gift ideas for people who are brand new to gardening or wanting to get into gardening. And so I'll share a few of those ideas as well. These types of gifts are going to be something very practical that the recipient will be able to use, and it will be something that won't just get set off to the side. We're gonna start off with some very basic tools that are a little bit less expensive. So here we have a lid lifter, and this has a magnetic point on the bottom, and that's going to allow you to go ahead and lift those lids out of hot water. And that's a great tool for making sure that you're not burning your fingers. Another tool that canners need would be a jar lifting tool. This tool, as well, is going to save your hand from getting burnt. You use it to lift the jar out of the boiling water or out of the hot canner so that you can place it on the counter to be able to cool. And then we have, of course, a funnel. And this is very important for making sure that the food is going directly into the jar. And when you keep your rims clean, it can help you to have a higher success rate as far as your jar sealing. Now, you can buy those items separately. Oftentimes they do come in a kit, and I noticed that Amazon has a few different kits on sale for their Cyber Monday sale, and I will link those down below. And just browse around and see what might fit with what you're looking for. Stainless steel lasts a long time, which is why I have that one. I think I originally picked up a kit that contained a plastic one, and then I bought the stainless steel funnel at a later date. But there are some kits now that have stainless steel items directly in them, so that's kind of a nice thing. Another one of my favorite canning tools would be this scoop. I use it for everything. It's great for getting out your canned items. It fits about a half pint of food in there, and so it's easy to fill up your half pints. I like that it has the pouring edge on it, so that's a nice feature. And then it has a little lip on the back, so you can hang it on the side of your pot so that if you are having to rearrange some of your jars, or if you need to set it down for a minute while you're getting something else, you don't have to worry about losing your scoop inside of the pot, and you also don't have to worry about setting it down on the counter or accidentally contaminating it with something else that's nearby. If you are getting a gift for someone who has a lot of canning items already, you might consider an immersion blender. This is a relatively new addition that I got maybe a couple years ago, and it has been really helpful when it comes to some of your sauces or soups where you need just part of it to be blended up, and you don't want to have to worry about putting it into a blender and pouring it back into the pot. It just can really be a great tool for canning. It's also a great tool to have around the kitchen, as I said, for soups and things. Sometimes you want to make a soup that's a little creamier, and so you want to blend just a portion of that before you go ahead and add in the chunkier piece, and the immersion blender is really helpful for that. So if you have somebody who already has a lot of the canning items, this might be a great tool to add to their kitchen. Those are some of the smaller items. As we're thinking about the overall canning process, having a set of colanders can be really helpful when you're trying to wash your produce and prepare it for food preservation. So no matter what you're doing, if you're gonna can, freeze, dehydrate, you wanna have clean produce going into things. And so it's really nice to have those colanders available to be able to wash all of your produce. If someone is just getting into canning, you do need to have a canner. When it comes to water bath canning, you have a couple of different options. You can get the water bath canner that will sit on the stove, and that's something that many people use. I have opted to use an electric water bath canner, and I will link to that as well as a couple of options for an on the stove version in the description below. but I do like the water bath canner because it frees up some of my stove space. So I can have the water bath canner going and another batch of something else coming along behind it, and I can feel like I have room to work and everything has enough space. When you're canning and using larger pots, it does take up a lot of your stove space. And so if you have your canner on the stove, plus you're trying to get another pot going, and if your kitchen is kind of small, it can feel like a lot of stuff. Now, some people don't prefer the electric water bath canner because they don't want to take up counter space with the canner. So you kind of have to weigh that out as far as what's going to be the best benefit. The other reason why I originally purchased the electric water bath canner was because at the time I had a glass top stove. I don't know if all stoves are this way, but I know many of the glass top stoves can't hold the weight that comes from putting a canner on the stove. And so I didn't want to have to worry about setting up the stove outside for my water bath portion at least. I did do that for pressure canning, but I didn't want to have to worry about that for my water bath canning. So that was another reason why I originally purchased the electric water bath. You have to play that by ear. Maybe your stove, if you have a glass top, can hold the weight of that, but that is something that needs to be considered when you're deciding on whether you want an electric or one to go on the stove. If you're wanting to do pressure canning, that's going to require a different kind of canner. And so if the person that you are gifting this to wants to do pressure canning, you might want to consider getting a pressure canner. I have the Presto, and that's what I'll link to. I really like the double decker just because I can stack up two layers of pints in there. If you're canning something that requires a longer processing time, it's really nice to be able to have that second layer and be able to just cook that all at one time. Again, if there's a glass stovetop involved, you do want to consider whether or not that weight can be handled on that stovetop, because especially with a double decker, it does weigh considerably more. And so you might want to look at outside cooking options, such as a camp stove or something like that, that you can go ahead and do that canning outside. Of course, in addition to having the canners, you do need to have a larger stock pot to be able to prepare the food in. If you're cooking something down, it has to be in a larger pot. And I will link to one that's similar to what I have. I have a heavy duty stainless steel one, and this was an absolute game changer for me. When you're canning, you have large batches of things. And so because you have increased volume, it's really important that you have this pot that's going to be able to accommodate that. You also need something that's really heavy on the bottom so that it helps to prevent scorching and burning. You don't want to have things scorching and burning during the canning process. So this was a game changer, and it was something that was gifted to me for my birthday actually, and something that I have been utilizing regularly ever since. So I know firsthand, even though it's a bit expensive, this can be a wonderful gift for someone who is trying to do food preservation. Canning is not the only type of food preservation that someone might be interested in doing. Dehydrating is another very popular form of food preservation that many people enjoy. This past year, I purchased a new dehydrator, and I have been loving this dehydrator. It has 10 racks, they're stainless steel, so it's easy to clean, and I can get a larger volume of food in the dehydrator at one time. I love that it has the timer and it's digital, and so it's just really easy for me to be able to use. It has the front opening door, easy access. There's the jerky hanging rack, so you're able to hang jerky inside, and that is a wonderful addition as well. And you can take all the racks out and do yogurt or other things in there as well. There are many different options as far as dehydrators go. I just happen to really like this particular one. Some of the things that you might want to consider when purchasing a dehydrator is where the heat source is coming from and the airflow that's going to be going around all of the trays. In this particular case, it has a fan in the back, so I feel like the airflow is pretty even. When I've had dehydrators that just had the heat source coming from the top. A lot of times my lower racks would not get the heat to dehydrate as regularly, and so I would have to rotate trays. I just had to watch it really carefully to make sure that all of the trays were actually getting the warmth needed to dehydrate. And so that wasn't my favorite part about the dehydrators that had heat coming just from the top. So when you're purchasing a dehydrator, just kind of keep that in mind. Where is the heat coming from and what kind of airflow are you going to be able to find? Another really handy tool for people who are doing food preservation is a food saver or something similar to that. I just added that to my food preservation toolkit this year, and I really like how it just sucks all of the air out, and I felt like my food was in a really good state to go into the freezer. So I've used that this year. I've also repackaged some items that I've purchased in bulk. I put them into smaller packages. I was able to put that into the food saver bag, get all of that extra air out of there, and I feel like that's definitely going to store better and last longer than if I had just let it sit in the original packaging. So a food saver can be a great addition for people as well. If you are wanting to go more with a book or something like that, a couple of great recommendations. This is the ball canning book. This has a lot of information in there about canning in general. You can find information about how to use a water bath canner, some information or some different recipes in here as well. It just has a lot of the good tried and true methods and information for safe canning practices. So this is a great book to have for someone getting into canning. I picked up this book this year, and it's The Complete Guide to Pressure Canning. It has a lot of canning recipes that you can do and use your pressure canner for. And again, just a lot of information about safe canning practices and different things to consider when you are going to be doing pressure canning. And I've really enjoyed this book. I've made quite a few recipes out of there this year, and I've been trying some of those and they've been really good. If you're focusing more on dehydrating, this book is called The Complete Dehydrator Cookbook. It has a lot of information about how to dehydrate your fruits, vegetables, and meats. And again, recipes that you can use. And things that you can do with your dehydrated fruits, vegetables, and meats. And then this is not a canning book all by itself, but it's got some canning recipes in there as well as being a great cookbook. I love the More with Less cookbook. It just has a lot of staple recipes. They use a lot of ingredients from your pantry. A lot of the items are just basic staples that you would have in your cupboard. And this is just a great cookbook and also a book with recipes for canning as well. And I've been using this for a long time. All right, moving on to gardening. This is a wide, expansive area, and you could cover a lot of different types of gifts within this. Of course, hand tools are always an amazing gift, and I will link in the description below to a video that I had done about some of my favorite hand tools. That way, if you want to see some of those, you can. Today, we're just gonna talk about a couple of items that I think present nicely and could be great for someone who is getting started. First up is to kind of make a little cute kit that has seeds in it and just, again, presents well. So you could use a colander, or you could do a hod, a harvesting hod, kind of like this. And if you put some tissue paper or some fluff in there, kind of fluff things up. And then you can put whatever seeds you want to gift inside the hod or inside the strainer. And this can just be a great starter kit. So it could be a variety of greens. You could do some different lettuces, spinach, things like that. If you wanted to do an assortment of some of your favorite varieties of foods or some of your favorite items that you like to eat from the garden, you can kind of build this up a bit and then present it in a way that would be kind of cute and festive. That's just one way that you could gift some seeds. I will link down below to a herb garden that I think would make a great gift. It is on Cyber Monday sale right now. And I ordered one for myself just to have some herbs and things indoors. And so we'll see what that looks like when I get it. But it looks like it presents nicely in the package, at least from the picture. Might be another option if you wanted to do something for someone who maybe is short on space and needs to do something a little more indoors, but they want to try their hand at growing something. Little containers or container gardening kinds of ideas might be a good option for them. The other thing that can be really handy is some type of a calendar. If you have a calendar to keep track of when you're planting things, what you're planting, that's just a great thing for all gardeners. And so having something like that to gift to even an experienced gardener might be a great idea. Other things that you might consider for the gardening enthusiast might be gloves or seed starting trays and seed starting materials. I've used the soil blockers, which are a great sustainable way to get your seeds started. And so the trays or the seed blockers themselves make for a great gift. Just a different way of seed starting that is going to last a really long time. And so that can be something that is perfect for someone who is getting started with gardening. Again, you kind of have to gauge how well you know the person and how serious they are about that. If the person is just starting to dabble in gardening, you might want to just start with some seeds and something simple. If they're maybe they've started doing some gardening and they're wanting to continue with that and it seems like something they're going to stick with, that's when you could step it up to something a little bit more like seed starting items, such as the soil blockers. I'm sure that there are some of our community members who have lots of ideas as well. And so if you have some ideas of what you think would make a great gift for someone who's getting into food preservation or someone who is just getting into gardening, leave that in the comments below and let's kind of build up our list of ideas. Sometimes it's hard to think about what we can give to those who are wanting to get involved in food preservation and gardening, but when we get some ideas, it can get some of those creative juices flowing and we can have a lot of different things that we can choose from. I hope today's video was helpful to you. If it was, don't forget to click like. We'd love to have you subscribe and be part of our community here where we have weekly videos about gardening, harvesting, food preservation, all of those kinds of things. Until next time, bye everyone.